Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. David Canton, Director of the African American Studies Program at the University of Florida, and welcome to our annual African American Studies Program convocation. So every September, we have a convocation where we kind of set the tone for the year in terms of our program, what we're trying to accomplish, what we accomplished last year, and really get the word out of what different events that we have during the next academic year. As you know, I started last August. This is my second year. I'll be talking about two new hires later in the discussion. And we also have folks talking about a book coming out in the next few months about the history of African Studies at UF. Before I begin, I'd like to thank our co-sponsors, CAME Arts, Center for Arts Migration Entrepreneurship, the University of Florida School of Music Harmony Initiative, A Stage for All Voices, the College of Liberal Arts and Science, the Samuel Proctor Oral History Program, the History Department, and the African American Studies Department, all co-sponsors in this great event. So the African American Studies program started here in 1969, 1970 with Dr. Ronald Foreman as the first chair and director. And the next two speakers on our program is Dr. Paul Ortiz and Dr. Jacob Gordon, who'll be talking about this historical monograph titled African American Studies 50 Years at the University of Florida. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. I'm Jacob Gordon, Professor Emeritus from the University of Kansas. I'm also a member of the retired faculty of UF. This book is a product of the symposium we held in February 2020. The symposium was entitled Looking Back, Moving Forward, a Kind of Sankofa. It was actually designed to commemorate the 50th anniversary of African American Studies program at the University of Florida. The symposium was divided into three parts. First part was the students and alumni. Second part was the community engagement. And the third part was the faculty symposium. I'm very glad. I want to acknowledge a lot of people who have worked on this program. Dr. My co-editor, Paul Dix, who is professor of history and director of the Proctor History Project. He was able to provide a lot of resources from his office to help us put this book together. I want to acknowledge the work of many people in this endeavor, particularly a little sister, Dr. Tricia Nunn, who in first chapter and finished it. She died before she finished it and went ahead and completed that chapter. And I think it's about the history of African American Studies at the University of Florida. That's what that chapter is all about. I'm also grateful to our incoming director, chair of the program, Dr. David Canro, the forward for this book. Very, very fascinating account of the evolution of African American studies in this country. The book provides an overview of the historical development of African American studies in the American Academy, focusing on development right here at the University of Florida. We built upon a lot of work done by other professors, such as Karaji Woodson, the father of Black history, we call him, and many other writers. That was the context in which we were able to discuss this program at the University of Florida. The book has 9 chapters, and each of them focusing on work done, the master's accomplishments of the program, the university for the past 50 years, and also point to the future. What can we do in the future? The new commitment towards a departmental structure was a part of this book. There are three features of the book I'd like to call your attention to. One, there are illustrative captioned photos in every chapter of the book to illustrate what actually took place. There are also study questions in the book for students and others who want to read deeper into the book. An appendix is a special feature of the book, which is a list of the research products of the faculty members in African American studies since its inception. Very, very fascinating. And we are hoping to launch this book once it comes out. It'll be in two versions. There'll be a digital version, which will be open to anyone to access. And then it will be a printed version. It's being published by the Library Press of University of Florida. That is an imprint of the University of Florida Press. And we are going to launch the book. It's my pleasure now to ask if my co-author, co-editor will focus on some of the issues raised in the book, Dr. Paul Hicks. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share this with you.
Thank you, Dr. Gordon. And it's been one of the great privileges of my academic career to be able to work with really an internationally renowned scholar. I don't know if people know this, but Professor Jay Gordon is internationally renowned for his work on the African diaspora. He's a tremendous scholar. He's a tremendous member of our community and an activist. And I think that really kind of personifies the spirit behind this book. As Jake mentioned, African-American Studies, 50 years at the University of Florida, we're on the cusp of publishing this book, is being published by the Library Press at UF, which is an imprint of the University of Florida Press. We're just so honored to be able to work with this fabulous press. It's been such a great experience. This is a book, colleagues, that is really going to help continue to put African-American Studies at the University of Florida on the map, both nationally and internationally. Its significance to the discipline of African-American studies is enormous because it actually talks about what makes African-American studies unique, what connects it to other academic disciplines, and what makes it unique here at the University of Florida. And I can walk you through a couple of the chapters. Chapter 2 is titled Black Students Struggles for Justice at the University of Florida by David L. Horn. And many of you know David Horn is a faculty member in the California State University system, renowned for his scholarship. But back in the day, he was a student at the University of Florida. And he was a leading student activist of the Black student movement and what we call back then the Third World Liberation Movement. And it was the energy of that movement that really helped establish African-American studies at the University of Florida. This is what makes Black studies so distinctive and so unique. And so this book will highlight the connections between community organizing, such as that engaged in by David Horn and his generation, the scholarship, the publishing, the engagement with the outside world, the impact that African-American studies has made as an interdisciplinary field. Another thing that makes this book unique is it lists, as Professor Gordon mentioned earlier, the resources, the books, the articles, the essays, the collections that African-American studies faculty at UF have contributed to the world of Black studies. And another thing, I'm looking at chapter 4, the state of African-American studies collections at the University of Florida by our colleague Stephanie Birch, who's the African-American studies bibliographer at the University of Florida. And I'm not saying this just because Dean Judy Russell is on the line, but I just want to let you know, if you're new to the University of Florida, we have the best library system in the country of all the universities that I know of. And Stephanie Birch is one of those great colleagues at the libraries who does so much work on behalf of African-American studies and making resources available to our students. And we're so proud of the fact, and Jake started this off by talking about the symposium, which celebrated that 50th anniversary of African-American studies. And a critical part of that symposium and in this book is highlighting these incredible collections we have here at UF. Print collections, video collections, oral history collections. You know, we have oral histories with almost every single one of the first cohort of African-American students at the University of Florida. We have a play that was produced by the UF College of Arts and Theater called Gator Tales. That's part of this collection. We have oral history interviews with Lawrence Ghia, the co-founder of the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, with Fannie Lou Hamer. And so that's just kind of the tip of the iceberg, if you will, in terms of the resources that the book will highlight. I kind of want to close on a chapter near and dear to my heart. It was a chapter I wrote titled Oral History, Democracy, and the Power of Memory. And this is a chapter which really highlights the connections between the storytelling traditions, oral history, the power of memory. It highlights the great oral history work of our students. Many of them have been our research assistants over the years for African American studies. People like Justin Donovan, who was a grad student here, who's now an assistant professor in anthropology at UCLA. People like Justin Hosby, who is a grad RA here, who did many of these oral histories you'll be reading about in the book. Justin Hosby is an assistant professor of anthropology at Emory University. Raja Rahim, who's now an assistant professor at Appalachian State University in history. The list goes on and on. So I guess what I'm trying to highlight here is the book demonstrates the academic rigor and also the fact that of the discipline, and also the fact that African-American studies majors, y'all, get really good jobs. And as a professor here at UF, I'm always cognizant of that. We always have to kind of justify ourselves with the state legislature. Another student whose work is in here who did interviews is Allison Mitchell. And Allison Mitchell interviewed many African-American elders for the oral history project called the Joel Buchanan Archive. And by the way, Allison is a history PhD candidate at the University of Virginia. And she just won our Julian Pleasant's Travel Award for outstanding oral history work. And as many of you know, our dear colleague, Julian Pleasant's, who directed the Samuel Proctor Oral History Program, recently passed away just last week. So there's a tremendous talent in here. It's a tremendous story about the intersections of African-American studies, community organizing, the fact that African-American studies is thriving here more than ever under the leadership of Dave Canton and so many colleagues who are on this call right now. And lastly, I'll just echo what Jake said. We're dedicating the volume to Patricia Hilliard Nunn, who we feel is still with us in spirit. She is the animating spirit behind this entire project. We miss her so much, but she really made this book possible. So we're dedicating the book to her memory. And we have a lot of work to carry on her legacies, because Patricia was both a great scholar, a great community activist, and just a loving, loving person. So thank you again, Dr. Canton, for giving the space for us. And again, everyone, this is coming out soon. The title, African American Studies, 50 Years at the University of Florida. We're so excited, and thank you.
Thank you, Jake and Paul. That was the previous slide, was the cover of the text of the book that's coming out. So pay attention for it. And I think it might be one of the first local studies of African American Studies department in the nation. So again, provides that foundation, history, the past, the present, what we can do for the future to shape up this department to be one of the leading departments in the country. So for those of you who don't know, last year we had some searches, and today I'd like to have an opportunity for our new colleagues to spend the next couple of minutes introducing themselves, their research, and let people know what classes they teach and how they're gonna also add to this growing program, transitioning into a department. So without any further ado, I'd like to start with my colleague, Dr. Courtney Moore.
Good evening, everyone. Certainly a pleasure to be here. I'm excited to hear our presenter tonight. And I'm also really excited about the project that Dr. Ortiz and Dr. Gordon have undertaken. As I was sitting, one of the courses that I'm teaching is Intro to African American Studies. And so hearing about the project really parallels with what we've been discussing this week in terms of UF and the start of the program. So I'm excited to get that book and to be able to push that knowledge further, even more. The students are excited about it, and to for them to get a sense of the sacrifice that went in to the creation of this program, and for them to sit in the classes that they sit in, it really helps them to gain a better understanding of just how significant and rich the history is at the University of Florida. I'm really excited to be with the program. I graduated from the Department of History about a decade ago. My research examines adolescent girls, and essentially I look at what it was like to be a piece of property while going through puberty. And I examine those rites of passage. My goal at the university is to continue to push that research project forward. But beyond my research, I really want to help push the program from a program status to a department, which is something that Dr. Canton was very adamant about. He has clear goals for the program, and I'm excited to get in on the ground floor to help build that foundation. We also want to push a African-American studies major. And so one of the tasks that I've been charged with this year is to try to get that up and running. I'm hoping to have an interest meeting with students in the next month to see if we can begin to pull some of the top students who are already very much engaged in our classes together so that we can have a very strong student presence on campus. I'm excited about what the future holds, and I'm just looking forward to interacting and working with each of you all as we move this program forward. Thank you.
Dr. Stevenson, you're up.
Good afternoon. It is such a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Dr. Canton, for the invitation. I'm also excited about the book by Drs. Gordon and Ortiz. I have a section in my library for famous authors. So when I get that, when your book comes out, you can sign it and I'll put it in my library. I can maybe sell it for a couple of years from now for $100,000. I've been here, this is my third year here. I came down as a visiting professor. I teach African and African American studies. I hold a PhD from Michigan State University in African and African American studies. I also hold two master's degrees in biblical studies and theology from Fuller Theological Seminary. I have a THM in African American church history and theological research methods, and a doctorate of divinity from the Southern California School of Ministry. My primary area of research and interest is the Middle Passage. I look at suicide by drowning as a form of resistance. So I study West African cosmologies. I'm also a certified scuba diver, and I work with Diving with a Purpose and NOAA, the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, on slave ships. I've done several underwater expeditions on a ship called the Guerrero off the coast of Florida. And I just got an email today. I'm applying to get the training necessary to do a study abroad in Africa. I think that if you're going to major in African American studies, you need to get a chance to go to Africa. I've been there several times. I taught in a high school in South Africa. And so hopefully next year we'll be able to add to our curriculum by taking students in onto the continent and helping them to understand really the essence of what it means to be African and in African American studies. And finally, I came here as well as Dr. Moore to help develop the department here. And besides the fact it doesn't snow in Florida, I wanted to make sure that my gifts and talents could assist when Dr. Canton came to take us from a program to a department. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Stevenson. Where you get them glasses, brother? You sharp.
You know how us alphas do. We always do.
Oh, here we go. All right. Okay. We're going to start that, huh? All right, Brother Brown, Dr. Drew Brown, recent hire here at the University of Florida African Studies Program, Sociology. You're up.
I don't know if I should come in with my hooks up already or what, but...
I can't take two cues in the same place.
I just want to thank everyone for being here and welcoming me in. Dr. Ken, definitely want to thank him for bringing me in here. I'm Drew Brown, and I originate from Windsor, Ontario, Canada. And so I'm just outside of Flint. So Dr. Stevenson, Flint and Windsor are a long way from Gainesville, certainly much colder up there. I'm at the University of Delaware for this last semester. and I study race, sports, and culture. I focus on Black culture in sports, and I do have one book out. It's right here, called Sports in African American Life and Culture, and I'm working on another book called Baller Culture, where I look at the sporting culture of the 1990s and 2000s, and looking at how it was heavily influenced by street and hip hop culture. And so if you think of someone who embodies that the most, you would probably think of someone like Allen Iverson. And that's the culture that I study in this next book, looking at how Black folks have used that culture to express their creativity, to reach their sort of goals of masculinity, and allowing them to resist assimilation at the same time in very creative ways. So that's what I do. I'm a former football player. I played professional football. I played collegiate Division I and then went on to play professional football for a little bit, and took that passion and my passion for the liberation and freedom of Black folks. And here I am in Africana Studies, studying Black culture and sports. I hope that I get to meet everyone that's on this panel pretty soon. I can't wait to engage with the students down there at the University of Florida. I've heard tremendous things about them, and I'm just happy and proud to be here.
Thank you, Dr. Brown, and we're looking forward to you coming on campus. He's teaching a course, online course next semester, Race and Sports in America, across this sort of sociology, and definitely looking forward to getting here and getting engaged and helping us build this department. Our next person who cannot be here, I'm gonna share my screen. Can y'all see her? Yeah, okay, good. So we have Dr. Richay Daniel Barnes, BA from Political Science, Spelman College, MS Urban Studies from Andrew Young School of Public Policy at Georgia State University, MA and PhD in Anthropology from Emory University. Currently, she's associate professor at Mount Holyoke College, and she's the author of Raising the Race, Black Career Women, Redefine Marriage, Motherhood, and Community in 2015, and was the winner of the 2017 Distinguished Book Award given by the American Sociological Association. She's currently completing projects expanding on a conceptual framework, Black Strategic Mothering, and applying the concept to understanding how Black mothers navigate school choice, the impact of perinatal health outcomes. She is the current president of the Association of Black Anthropologists. And next semester, she'll be teaching an online course called Sex and Gender in the Black Diaspora in spring 2022. So there's a book on the right there. She starts next semester, couldn't make it this evening, but she's definitely part of the team. And again, looking forward to helping us transition this program into a top-ranked department. So that's a hire. So again, this year we're hiring some more faculty. The ads will be coming out soon. So again, I think we're going to doing it the old school way. We're bringing people to campus. So hopefully next semester, stay up on our webpage. There'll be announcements. Candidates will come to campus, do lectures, do talks. So it's an opportunity for people to come in and engage scholars and see what they're about and really be participatory in the process. So I think we're looking forward to it, and you know, just be on the lookout for it. Okay, so putting this together, I know there's some of those two major music events. What's that? The Summer Cultural, the Questlove, his documentary on the Harlem cultural event was on Prime Video this summer, looking at 1969, we had the Harlem cultural event. And then just recently, the documentary on Rick James was on Showtime. So we definitely know the impact that, you know, African-American music, whether it's jazz, blues, hip hop, funk, go-go, is a major part of African-American studies. However, as Dr. Brown's gonna share with you, I think the difference is how, as a discipline, do we engage African-American music? Is it just aesthetics? Is it aesthetics, business, politics? Is it all together? And how do we engage that music, which, as we know, is a major part of this experience? So I think when you listen to Dr. Brown's lecture, it's more so than just the aesthetics part. That's one part of it. But I think, as he'll tell you, the genius part and also the business part. I teach a hip hop class, and I use Grandmaster Flash, has an hour segment where he shows you how his genius of putting together being a DJ. We took a crayon, he scratched it on a record, and I'm sitting there, who thinks of, I mean, that's genius. Who does that? And when he explains it, I think oftentimes in Black music, that's what gets lost, because we always focus on either what we think it is, the dancing part only, or we think of what people are saying lyrically. But when you sit down and watch that video, and I've watched it numerous times, I still can't figure it out. In fact, he should get a posthumous MacArthur Genius Award, because it's just genius, right? So one day I'll share that link with folks. And when you see it, you really get a deeper appreciation of DJing and the science of hip hop, rather than what most people have is a rudimentary understanding. So without further ado, let me go read the introduction, and then Dr. Brown, you could take it away. Dr. Scott Brown is a leading scholar of Black history, African-American studies, popular culture, and music. He is currently vice chair of African-American studies at the University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA, and the author of Fighting for Us, Milana Karanga, The Us Organization, and Black Cultural Nationalism. He's also the author of Discourse on Africana Studies, James Turner, and Paradigms of Knowledge, as well as publications in scholarly periodicals and compilations, American National Biography, Contributions in Black Studies, Liner Notes, Issues in African-American Music, Journal of Black Studies, Black Scholar, Freedom North, Malcolm X Historical Reader, Journal of African-American History, Black Los Angeles, The Funk Era and Beyond, American Studies Journal, Africana Methodology, Langston Hughes Review, and the Dayton Anthology. Beyond academia, Dr. Brown has contributed to numerous articles in major media outlets such as New York Times, Los Angeles Times, Ebony Magazine, EU Web, Fresh, Hip Hop and R&B, The Hype Magazine, Oprah Magazine, and USA Today. He has appeared as an expert commentator for television, film, and radio programs on National Public Radio, Sirius XM Radio, BET Centric, PBS, TV One, VH1, Cinemax, and Euro News. Brown is also an independent music producer and songwriter with original compositions featured on most digital music platforms. Dr. Brown recently served on the advisory council for the acclaimed Warner Brothers film, Judas and the Black Messiah. So please welcome Dr. Brown. Everyone go on mute if you're not speaking. And as we get, he'll talk for the next 50 minutes. If you have questions, put them in the chat and I'll read them in the order as they appear. Thank you.
Hello there, greetings everybody. I hope you can hear me okay out there. It's always a challenge when we're trying to engage community with such mediums as this, that they bring us together, but there's nothing like that same feeling you get when you're in the same space. So I really wish and look forward to being with you in dialogue, but hopefully this is the beginning step toward us having in the same space, learning from one another. I'd like to say first that really want to join the chorus of those of you who are excited about the book that Professor Gordon and Professor Ortiz are working on, that story of the history of Black studies, both the Black studies movement and the institutions that that movement gave birth to, is still being written. And so much of what we envision going forward is going to be deeply connected to how we tell the story and frame the story of Black studies, of Africana studies, of African-American studies, whatever name you feel connected to that story, Pan-African studies. I see I got Professor Gordon going, let me try to think of another one. That's all I'm gonna go with for now, but the nomenclature and the diversity in the nomenclature does not convey the singularity of the idea of academic excellence and social responsibility that bringing together of the idea of knowledge production and change in real world terms. So I'm very happy for that. I'd like to thank also the Department of African American Studies, the School of Music, also Kane, the Center for Arts Entrepreneurship, and all that put this event together. I'm gonna try to build off of a point that Professor Canton just raised, and that is this idea of genius. Talked about the genius of Grandmaster Flash. This slice of a bigger project I'm gonna share with you is trying to tackle a question I'm looking at, and that issue of how do we think about this phenomenon known as funk and funk music? How do we think about its presence even today? How do we think about it in contrast to this idea of rise and fall? How do we think about continuities and how the river continues? The individual genius of Grandmaster Flash, the individual genius of Patrice Rushen, the individual genius of Chaka Khan, of Stevie Wonder, the individual genius of African artists, not just in music and beyond, is a very important aspect of how we tell the story of Black music. But it's not quite, biography is not quite dealing with music from what I'm hoping to be an Africana studies paradigm of engaging music. Genius is obviously important, but what we're looking at here, or what I'm trying to engage, is this question of community genius. Take Prince outside of Black Minneapolis, the Wade Cultural Center that gave him lessons when he was a youngster. Take the availability of manufacturing jobs away from Joe Jackson, who could support his family and manage the group that became the Jackson Five. Take away that space in the public sphere known as the Apollo Theater. Then individual genius cannot be heard. So my work is trying to, from a Black Studies perspective, think about all of these other institutions, people, networks that give us this tremendous resource known as Black music. Now, Cameo is a funk band, and I have to argue with my students, because I said to my students, we get into these debates, I said, there are no Black bands. And they said, yes, there are. And I like all the artists they're mentioning, so I'm not showing any disfavor with these artists. They say, well, Erykah Badu has a band. Yes, Erykah Badu has a great band. And then they'll say, well, D'Angelo has a great band. Yes, he does. He has a fantastic band. But there's a difference between what? Having a band and, we can say it together, being a band. I'll tell you some names of some bands. If you have access to the chat, type some names of bands that you like. And just to give you a sense of what this thing a band is. First of all, there's a name. You can have a person's name, but there is something else connected to it, okay? There's the person that Dr. Canton just mentioned, Rick James and the what? Stone City Band, Cameo, Slave, Lakeside, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Parliament-Funkadelic. Those are bands, the Gap bands. So I wanna really talk about this phenomenon of this unit of artistic creation, Cool in the Game. This unit that flourished in the 1970s that disappeared so quickly in the 1980s from the public square, but still existed, but was not being pushed. And what are the forces that pushed it out? And then how does it linger as an important creative unit in African life, Black life, African life, Pan-African life, Professor Gordon, Africana life, all of these different ways of saying the Black world, if you will. So community genius, the genre that Black bands are most associated with in the period that I'm talking about is known as funk music. Now let's make a distinction. Not all Black bands are funk bands, and not all funk is made by a band, okay? So this infectious, danceable style, which emphasizes rhythm and a set of sound relationships known as the groove, gets captured in many words. The word, the four-letter word funk, sounds like a lot of other things, but it's a musical style that reached a peak in commercial popularity in the 1970s through the early 1980s. What's interesting about funk is that everybody knows it when they feel it, but it's very difficult to define. But yet you still know, if someone says, yo, man, that's that funk. If I really start getting to a higher level of playing ball on the court, playing my bass guitar, giving a lecture, and I'm someplace, he said, Doc Brown, you was bringing that funk. What are they talking about? We're hard pressed to know what it is, but we know it when we feel it. While the term did not garner official sanction as a chart category in Billboard magazine, numerous musicians either explicitly identified as funk artists or described their music as funk, or at the very least, they said the music is funky. Like most musical styles, the distinction between funk and other styles is neither fixed nor consistent. Now, I'm gonna play some funk for y'all, some of which some people might feel, others may not. But I just wanna give you a sense for where I'm coming from when I'm talking about the self-contained band and the funk. And that is the relationship between numerous parts. And not to oversimplify things, but if you ever get a chance to visit that great country of Senegal that I visited, or Gambia, got to go to Banjul, and get around the drum circle, you'll see that there are some parts that in an individual way are not necessarily very interesting. The June drum holding down that bass might just be going boom, 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 boom. But it's the relationship, the polyrhythmic relationship of all of these, the djembes, the different tones in repetition. As Prince said, that great philosopher artist Prince said, there's joy in repetition. And the funk plays in that joyous sweet spot where repetition actually gives space for improvisation and the maintenance of a kind of trance-like groove. So just bear with me. If this music is too loud, just let me know somehow and I'll figure out how to turn it down. I'll probably keep it down low and then work my way up, all right? Let's start with, and there are a lot of questions about what 80s funk sounds like, but let's go with the title track that this lecture is named after, that Professor Canton gave it, Word Up. Can you all hear that? Now that's 1980s cameo. So that sound, if you notice, at least in that part, there are horns that come in later on, but synthesizers and drum machines and other technologies do what a different set of instruments did in a previous era. So if you listen to Cameo just maybe 4 or 5 years earlier, you'll hear a different kind of sound. You'll hear horns, you'll hear timbales and percussion. Most of those instruments by the 1980s were displaced by technology. So I want you to listen to, somebody recommended that I play a song by Cameo that it's not a popular song, but you'll hear their whole different sonic arrangement in 1978, 79, when they were a 10-piece band with a horn section. Just listen to this. It almost sounds like a different band. When you hear a group that moves you and you feel it in your feet, you ask yourself, hold on a minute, what group can this be? So I'm going to stop, because what happens is if I keep playing this funk too long, you all are going to see some very bad dance moves. I didn't say I was necessarily one who is totally immersed in the funk. Not all that I do is funky. And let's just say dancing is not my strong suit, but I do put an A into the F. Let's move now with talking about that sound. You can hear a different 80s approach. Cameo is also one of the few funk bands that had a presence in this new medium in the 80s of music video. If you saw the Rick James documentary, Rick James, huge platinum selling artist, had music videos that MTV would not play. The racial barrier was broken when the story goes that CBS Records threatened to pull all of their artists off of MTV, all their white artists, rock artists, everybody, if they did not play the video Billie Jean. And so Michael Jackson gets in first, Prince follows suit, Little Red Corvette. There always were a few artists, eclectic Black artists like Grace Jones or Eddie Grant that got played, but for the most part, Black artists weren't on. And Rick James was a casualty of that pushing out of, even though he had a big crossover hit. So Cameo comes and they downsize, just like the manufacturing base downsizes. There's a sonic companion to that downsizing. The band is smaller. Larry Blackmon is known for having some very unique costuming going on. We don't have to go into detail about that. If you want to look at some Cameo videos, you'll see that it's very, very difficult to ignore aspects of that costume. I'll leave it at that. But the point is that they were ready made for video. Larger bands, Earth, Wind, and Fire, believe it or not, Earth, Wind, and Fire's last big hit is 1980. Let's Groove Tonight. Earth, Wind, and Fire, with all the majesty of what you see live in concert, never found a vehicle to capture that in video that fit within the format of MTV. So a lot of phenomenal Black bands never actually had a place in music video. BET eventually finds spaces for them, but music was already kind of changing. So that whole era of 70s big band funk really gets shut down by some of these things. But there are other things that change as well. Let me name some of the other bands that were popular in the 70s. Mandrill, the Ohio Players, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Pleasure, Grand Central Station, the Isley Brothers, Rufus featuring Chaka Khan, the Bar Kays, the Meters, Mother's Finest, Brothers Johnson, so many others. Folk bands, as I said, are not synonymous with bands, and funk are not necessarily always overlapping. But as I said, they were the dominant artistic expression in the golden age of funk. But let us talk about the socioeconomic and cultural soil from which bands were born. Why did bands, and by extension, funk groups, decline as an artistic unit? The answer to that requires us to think about the institutional actors involved in the circulation of funk music within the urban community. And this is where a Black studies approach, rather than a more narrow disciplinary approach, is really the only way to get a comprehensive view of this. Opportunities for youth, recreation centers, support for parents, music in the schools, churches, mom and pop record stores, managers, disc jockeys, locally owned radio stations, local recording studios, vinyl pressing plants. All of these are part of the dynamic of race and power at the macro level of the music industry and the local level that shift very dramatically. It's a perfect storm for us in the early 1980s. Manufacturing jobs depart. A lot of the businesses that are surviving because of the revenue of these manufacturing jobs start to dwindle. The public sphere is being cut because of the Reagan era cuts. And so the experience of Black bands is this real perfect storm, not to mention something that I think I'll talk about more later. When we talk about the institutionalization of Black power, we often talk about the professional organizations that are formed. So we'll talk about, for instance, the Congressional Black Caucus. We'll talk about the Black Social Workers Organization, all the Black Studies organizations. We rarely talk about the impact of Black power on Black music executives. So you have this breakthrough of epic proportion of Motown Records, which dominates not just Black music, dominates popular music in ways that no one could have anticipated. In the early 1960s, pretty much through the latter 1960s. Prior to that, Black consumer markets for music on the part of big companies have been relatively ignored, seen as a small market share, left to the devices of what is called boutique labels, smaller record labels. Those winds change profoundly, and that's the contradiction. It has everything to do both with the popularity of bands in the 1970s in Black music, and also the development of Black megastardom. That is, the large companies start to form what is called Black divisions. Those Black divisions were staffed mostly by Black executives who came out of the Black music community in a very organic way. They were often disc jockeys. They were nightclub owners. They were people who were involved in the circulation of music. They worked in music retail. People like, you have the attorney, Larkin Arnold, who ends up negotiating huge deals, including the one for Michael Jackson, which gives us all kinds of powerful things that Michael Jackson's able to do. Prior to that, the Jacksons actually, when they left Motown, they went to CBS Records, but they also had an affiliation with a Black independent production company and label as well, Philadelphia International, Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff. But they're tied to CBS Records. So remember in the 1970s, for those of you who remember, the Jackson Five, not the Jackson Five, Not only do they have music, but they also have a television show, a variety show. Do you remember the Jacksons? So that's a function of these Black divisions. Now, these Black divisions, I talked about this with on the Joe Madison show. These Black divisions were having so much in the way of success and so much in the way of autonomy. And many of these executives saw themselves as carrying out this tradition of Black power in their own sphere. Even the term, the shift from the term Negro to Black was pushed by an artist that really identified with that spirit. Known as the Godfather of Soul, but he wears so many hats, he's also the structurally and musically and aesthetically, the one of the most, probably the most arguably contributor to the funk formula, and that is James Brown. But James Brown also was involved in some of these executive measures that would also give him some obstacles and opposition that he didn't anticipate into the 1970s. But he was a conservative-minded person economically, in a sense that he wasn't a radical trying to overthrow the system, but he believed in Black ownership and Black autonomous control over music. And that would also be something that caused problems for him. So that was really the tapestry in the 1970s that most bands were able to benefit from. That was the outreach. So you have right after Motown sort of begins to become more flexible in a sense that artists are now starting to take on political messages and other things. Right along that same time, you have also the shift in ownership of another important Black label, Stax Records, which is under now, by the early 1970s, the leadership of Al Bell, Black executive, very, very much interested in Black control. As a result of his leadership, you have one of the best, most powerful artifacts of this commingling of power, economic organization, and art. And that is the documentary that you all, as a homework assignment, must look at some point, called Watt Stax. That was the Stax artists, including comedians like Richard Pryor, and gospel artists like the Staples Singers. All of them formed this huge concert. We had the Summer of Soul, 1969, that you may have watched, but you also have, in the 7-year anniversary of the Watts Uprising in Los Angeles, in the LA Stadium, Watt Stax. It is phenomenal. Interestingly enough, both in the Summer of Soul and Watt Stax, Reverend Jesse Jackson, because of his organization's interest in economic empowerment, is present in both. So that's sort of the general environment out of which funk bands, this connection between popular sounds, economic solidarities, and also the sociologies of community. This network of places where artists perform. Sometimes we think of it in a derogatory way. Sometimes we understand it for what it is. This network of spaces known as the Chitlin Circuit. We often say that for anything that is Black, but maybe under-resourced, but a place where you see the most phenomenal Black talent. And those networks still exist at every level, but they existed in ways that were very important to the flourishing of funk. I remember when I went to, in 1980, I used to get in concerts. I was only 12, 13, 14 years old. And I would go to, instead of getting on the bus and going home after school, we had to transfer downtown. If there was a concert, I would go to the Holiday Inn where I'd see the tour buses. And so I met a lot of artists as a kid with my little demo tape, which is probably quite terrible. but I was trying to meet Rick James in 1980. That's when the Fire It Up tour was out. It was an amazing tour. Rick was the man. He's from Buffalo, 1 hour away from my hometown, Rochester, New York. I go to the hotel. Al Heyman, who is a huge promoter in boxing, actually was a concert promoter, the dominant black concert promoter. A lot of these things that I'm mentioning probably would be considered by our standards the Chitlin Circuit, in the sense that they're really black folks dealing with black communities, dealing with institutions, but they're very important. I go on a Holiday Inn, I'm looking for Rick James. Rick James, nowhere to be found. I'm bothering people, I'm getting on the elevator. Where is Slick Rick? You know. So eventually the security is getting mad, they want me out of there. Al Heyman, the promoter, said, look, you gotta get out of here. You know, you're causing too much trouble. And he usually, typically to get me out would say, bring some friends and he'll let me in the concert for free. Well, that particular day, when Rick was not there, I was told there's this new artist that's opening up named Prince. And there goes that guy, Prince, I was told. Prince had one album out before that. This was the self-titled one, the eponymous record. I Wanna Be Your Lover was out, but obviously, nothing that could hold a candle in my mind to Rick James. So, you know, I was looking for Rick James. I asked him, can I get your autograph? He was short in stature, I should say. I was a tall, lanky kid, but he signed my autograph. He had on these shades with mirrors, didn't say anything, just kind of looked at me and signed this autograph. And I was like, what you doing having an attitude? It's not like you're Rick James. So I go to the concert. You know, Prince was definitely getting people's attention, but Rick James had two column-sized simulated marijuana blunts on either side of the stage, blowing out dry ice, 10-piece band. I mean, it was mind-blowing. I would have never thought that the 10-piece band that I saw was on its way out. And what I was seeing beforehand was actually this future. In both cases, bands are going to persist, but that downsizing phenomenon that I mentioned earlier was actually going to happen now in a very clear artistic sense. Prince, at best, has six people on stage. Two keyboard players were doing all of the things that Rick James' horn section would have done. So that was sort of my encounter with it, but not really aware of these kinds of transitions. My father was not a fan of Rick James. He was a Motown era person. So he used to tell me, Rick James can't sing, which I couldn't believe that. How dare you? This is when parents become uncool, right? When they have a higher standard, they know they're right, but you know, it's sort of like the way people who like hip hop 1990s bars, they may like Tupac and they have to deal with what's happening in hip hop today. And they try to tell folks, you know, that's not really, and you're not gonna be heard. My father was not gonna be heard. I said, okay, Pops, no problem. And I just tuned him out. Now, what's important here for the story that we're looking at is this question of what constitutes old school and at what point do the institutions sort of line up with a preservationist agenda? So around the time that Rick James was very popular, P-Funk was popular, all these bands were popular, what an oldies or old school radio programmer was playing was The Temptations. They were playing Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell. They were playing Al Green. They were playing, and that constituted the old school. Now, as we kept moving along, we see that this thing, old school, I don't think there's an exact amount of time. It could be 20 years out. It could be, there is an increment of time that goes by whereby a previous genre is viewed as something that has to be preserved and and the vehicle of catering to the aging audience that loved it and also introducing it to a new generation. By the 1990s, we're dealing with a lot of changes that keep funk alive, but in a different kind of way. The last record label, R&B record label, Black-owned record label of the 1980s that really, really dominated was called Solar Records. That is the sound of Los Angeles records. Are you all familiar with them? Are you all familiar with this? I don't think you're familiar with Solar.
I'm familiar with Solar.
You're familiar with Solar?
Yes, sir.
Okay, but see, you strike me as, I see all those books behind you. So you're already scaring me right there. You probably have the only book that ever came out on Solar back there in that collection. So you're not representative here, brother. So we're going to have to still entertain the question more broadly, all right? Dr. Stevenson, can you just hold on tight. All right, so let's deal with this group Solar, this label Solar, and why it's so important, but why it's also the last record label, Black-owned record label, to flourish in the way that it did. I'm going to play some songs for you, and then you tell me if you recognize them, one of which Dave played. Professor Canton played. Lakeside. Let's see if you know this one.
Know that one too.
Second time around.
Second time around, bro.
All right, what about the only signed, commercially successful women's band, self-contained band, Climax?
Skate and rink music.
What's that?
Skate and rink music.
That's right. I had to leave my condo. Meeting in the ladies' room. Well, I'm back, but this time. Midnight Star. Or this classic.
Whispers. And the beat goes on.
All these songs were recorded and an expression of the dominance of Solar Records, which dominated the 1980s. And that label is even responsible for the very early start in the 1990s that Death Row Records is going to have. In fact, The Chronic was recorded in the building and recording studios of Solar Records. It's the only record label, Black record label, that didn't have a floor. There was actually a building built on Cahuenga. Dick Griffin was so committed to the idea of Black empowerment that the only Black architect, Ray Dons, in California, certified to build a skyscraper was the person who designed the building. It is to this day an architectural phenomenon because there's a studio that's up on one of the upper floors. And if you know about recording sound and the possibility of noise from vibrating girders and soundproofing, so many studios are not up in a high skyscraper type building because of that. That engineering feat was accomplished by Ray Dons. The interior design, everything that the CEO Dick Griffey could do to bring Black folks involved in that process, he accomplished. But this was a different era. This was an era when being a CEO was not about, especially someone like Mr. Griffey, wasn't about being a celebrity. The artists were the celebrities. And for that reason, it's really through a sensitivity to these kinds of achievements that a Black Studies approach will unveil the importance of Solar. Solar Records also funded and raised money for Frelimo in their fight against Portuguese colonialism in Mozambique. It also funded and raised money for the African National Congress when they were considered and defined as a terrorist organization in the 1980s. So you don't hear that in the music. You might hear Make This a Night to Remember. You might hear I Only Think of You on Two Occasions, but you're not gonna understand the politics and the political meaning of that institution unless you go below the surface of what Professor Kent called the aesthetics of sound. We have to deal with the politics of the unit that distributes and produces. But again, that was the accomplishment. But by the 1980s, Black labels were under great peril, in part because of this competition from these record labels that had Black divisions. In 1988, in fact, Motown Records was sold. Pop music historian David Sanjek observed in 1997 that Solar had distinguished itself from other recently established labels. He says, one can point to such recent enterprises as Sylvia and Joe Robinson's Sugar Hill Records, Dick Griffey's Solar Records, or Paisley Park Records. And those were pretty much the lasting institutions in the 1980s. Now, what's very interesting here, two developments that I'd like to show have this important role in the maintenance of funk. There's a big argument going on about what funk is and does funk just die? I was talking with a distinguished hip hop artist. We're having a debate named Oheni Savant. And he has a book called Becoming an MC. If you look his name up, Oheni Savant, you see he's got 20 albums and he's a rapper's rapper. He made the better point. He said, what people don't understand is hip hop is funk too. And that funk finds its way of maintaining itself in another period. So I thought more deeply about that. And I had to go back to the origins of recorded hip hop in the late 1970s. And I'm gonna play some of that early hip hop for you to make another kind of point. Let's see if you all remember this song. It's funny, when you stick around this thing long enough, you even discover that there are things that we call hip hop that a newer generation would probably beg to differ in terms of their own sonic preferences. But this is a group called Sequence. No, that's not it. This is Sequence. You know that one. This is all women's first highly publicized women's hip hop group. Notice the song is called Funk You Up. Might have to move forward a little bit. This is the disco version. In fact, Angie Stone, known as Angie B, was one of the rappers in that group. Great vocalist, Angie Stone, was in the group Sequence. Also, if you listen to some of the other music, think about the sounds you're hearing with the Sugar Hill Gang. You'll notice something that's very different about it that I'll talk about. Let me find another one that is something that you would recognize. That's classic, The Message. can't take the noise, got no money to move out. And then of course you have this great roller skating song right here. So that is an interesting phenomenon in its connection between funk and hip hop. Sugar Hill Records utilized the handiwork of live musicians. So when Sugar Hill Records starts to record, sampling technologies that become popular, which mimic breakbeats and the behaviors and the abruptness of a transition that DJs can do, was not really available to them yet. So they have live musicians, if you notice, that are trying to emulate the breakbeat. Even if you listen to the song, The Breaks by Curtis Blow, that's a live band playing it. Doug Wimbish, bassist, Skip McDonald, guitarist, Keith LeBlanc on drums, Craig Derry, the percussionist, playing those bongos on Apache, Wayne Mitchell on keyboards. They were the musicians. And when the Sugar Hill Gang went on tour, they went on tour with a live band in 1979 as the opening act for Parliament-Funkadelic on the Knee Deep tour. Funk was also reintroduced to latter day audiences by producers who sampled and interpolated previously recorded tracks and created new soundscapes. The bass lines and breakbeats of funk bands found new life in a form restructured to fit the auditory preferences of a younger group of listeners. Hip hop producers fattened the sounds of James Brown, Graham Central Station, Kool & the Gang, Isaac Hayes, The Meters, Grover Washington, and many other veteran music makers with sub-bass tones and drum machine overlays. The 1990s was actually a peak period in the use of sampled music from self-contained bands. And some areas would even have a special leaning. So if you look at West Coast hip hop, there's a leaning toward Ohio funk. Roger Troutman and Zapp, Junie Morrison, leaning toward Parliament Funkadelic, which is New Jersey and Ohio and other places. And then there are other regions that also chime in here. And let me just show you the original songs and the samples, and just hear how funk ends up finding a way of getting into our ear space in spite of these technological changes. The band still finds a way to play. One second, here we go. All right, so now let's look at this one. I'll play the hip hop song first on this case. Now, some of these artists, history has proven that they may not have turned out to be the kind of artists that have had the staying power, but they were popular in their time. It's Criss Cross, Tonight's the Night.
Criss Cross, 9-5. Yeah.
Who got you? Open, scoping out the track. It's no other than the sounds of the dead and Mac. Still slacking, back.
All right, that song is by, originally, the group called Fazo. Fazo, the O in Fazo stands for Ohio. Riding high. Kind of lowrider classic on the West Coast. Give me another one here. Another Ohio sample. 9-5. 90s people would love this. Yo, check out that situation right there, yo. Yeah, what's the Mary J. Blige, yo, honey, right there. Grand Pooba, 411.
Yeah, she got it going on and on, like, you know what I'm saying? But she be trying to act like all of that, though, yo.
So show us boss, man, what's up?
Yo, big kid style.
No question, big kids in full effect, man.
Yo, I'ma kick the Willie Bow with it. Check it, yo.
No question.
Ayo, what's the 411, hon?
What's the 411?
All right, that came.
I got it going on.
Song called Pride and Vanity by another Ohio band, the classic Ohio Players. Ohio Players were jazz musicians before they became funk artists, so they always slip some jazz tracks on the album. This one is this song. This is fun. This is fun. All right, let me go to the next song. I'm gonna play the other ones if I keep listening to this. Of course, you know this classic artist.
Something for my godson Elijah and a little girl named Corinne. Say the black of the belly, the sweet of the juice. I say the dark of the flesh and the deep of the roots. I get my
heart
and my staff on welfare. Two pockets, if don't nobody else.
Not H-Town, Zapp, Roger and Zapp. I can go on and on, but I'm going to give you a couple more. Of course, an anthem, West Coast hip hop.
One, two, three into the four. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the door, ready to make an entrance, so back on up, cause you know we're about to rip shit up. Give me the microphone first so I can
bust. Now here's Leon Hayward, Compton and Long Beach. I want to do something freaky. Almost Unchained. This is back when they did grooves that were so nasty, they didn't have to start singing until a minute into the song because you were just locked in. Let's do that. No wonder DJs ran to this, producers ran to this. Let me conclude before we get into questions. And the treasure trove of music from bands that began to show up in hip-hop recordings as early as the late 80s. Many of these groups were still recording, but they were mostly marginalized at the time. They were experiencing great hardship in the 1980s. But the grooves born of the relationships between musicians and easily overlooked institutions and supporters at the local level, musicians who practiced and performed in garages, basements, talent shows, neighborhood parks, would consistently find ways to impose themselves on changing technologies and new generations of music makers and listeners during the 1980s and into the 90s. By the time you get to the 90s, old school is now a reference to the funk. In the 90s, you have the first book that really summarizes the history of funk by Ricky Vincent, Funk, the Music, the People, the Rhythm of the One. In this period, you also have the beginnings of commemorative gatherings that reflect and celebrate the funk. Sinbad's Summer Jam, 1994, 95, every summer, every year in another place where people congregated, listened to all these veteran groups. Theme cruises now start to identify funk. When you look at music festivals, when people are thinking about a sound that brings people together, there's a way that the nostalgia about the time period comes through in these choices. I offer this to say that perhaps the old school beats, bass lines, and syncopations that had originated decades earlier from bonds forged by families of working people practicing in garages and basements, maybe those sounds imposed themselves on us. Maybe those sounds and that spirit imposed itself on technologies and generations of music makers and listeners. Even a slice of a funk song, sampled and reformulated, restructured, contains the vision, labors, creativity, and struggles of everyday people who made it, circulated it, with or without the notoriety. Only a Black Studies and Africana Studies paradigm of knowledge can extract and explain the multiplicity of factors that led to this idea of the band as a principal unit of Black creativity in this period. When we talk about hip hop, we usually talk about its origins as a consequence of lack. We didn't have music in schools, so we had to do this. We didn't have this, so we had to create that. That's true, but you know, there's more to that story as well. But what funk offers a glimpse into, and this is no by no means a romantic, perfect period. It gives you a glimpse though of what sound relates to a situation in which there's an availability of relatively high wage, working class jobs, union jobs, wherein one income can sustain a family, purchase instruments for kids, and involve in extramural activities and training. So if you want to find that sound of a period in time, it's a short window, it's a short one, but it's an important, it's just as important as it is to understand what ways we've had to adapt to not have it. What did we sound like when we had some things? I argue a lot of that can be found in the funk and in the Black band. I'll stop there, because you know, once I start getting going, we'll keep on going for another hour. So then I'll be the only one in the room with a few people. So let's stop here and get some questions. Thank you so much.
Appreciate it, Dr. Brown. You can put your questions in the chat. And I have a question I can start off. You know, we've talked before. He's a funk guy, Rochester. I'm a hip hop guy from the Bronx. And this old school, I remember Tom Joyner's show when they started. We don't play hip hop. We don't play, they were just over, we don't play hip hop. But we know now there's old school hip hop channels in Atlanta. Hip hop is on a Joyner show now, because obviously we're older. Do you see the same thing, hip hop tours and cruises? Do you see that same type of another, what, 10 to 15 years? That same type of thing we see with funk, with old school hip hop people?
Yes, well, you know, that was a big, well, I wouldn't say a blunder. And there's a couple of things happen that make for hip hop very difficult to be appreciated by a number of the elders and gatekeepers in Black culture making. One is, it's so particular in its early phases to New York City. I'm from Rochester, New York, 400 miles from New York City. And I'm gonna be, see, people, a lot of people are jumping on the band. They all act like they always loved hip hop. That's not true. That's not true. I was already playing in bands. I could not wrap my mind around the idea of somebody talking over music by Chic. The song was Good Times. So I said, man, what is this? This is, you know, and then I said, okay, I thought that was a one-off. Like most people thought Rapper's Delight was going to be a one-off. It was a little, it was cute, but they didn't see it going. I know many people did not see that coming, because there was a subculture that have far more depth. In fact, most of the hip hop artists involved in the hip hop community did not even like Rapper's Delight. They didn't think those were real MCs. They didn't think the rhymes were, I mean, Melly Mel did not like it at all. So it was easy for us to think of it as a novelty because the first hit record was a novelty record. Hip, hop, hip, it, hip, 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 hip. That, they were already doing far more sophisticated things at the Roxy and all these places where the art form was being crafted. But it was mediated through, and you know, you had an R&B record label, formerly All Platinum Records, which became Sugar Hill Records. Sylvia Robinson, R&B artist, you know, kind of building something from it, but not necessarily a product of the culture in a way, but somebody who was, had the entrepreneurial savvy to understand it could be recorded. Most MCs did not see making a record because this was a live performance art form. You had to be at the party and rock the party. So the idea of making a record, I was listening to an interview with Grandmaster Cass. He said, you can't make a record with rap. That doesn't make sense. So that was enough for many of us. And I'm of the age where I probably should have, I regret, because all this work I had to do trying to learn how to play bass, I really wish I would have spent some time learning how to rap. I would share some bars with y'all if I could, but it's embarrassing, so I'm not going to even try. But those who understood its depth fought the fight of being ridiculed. Curtis Blow performed on Soul Train. He had a suit on. I think, I don't know who made him wear the suit. He had no shirt on underneath the suit though, you know? So there were, it wasn't, and it was clearly something not well received by the great host, Don Cornelius. So after Curtis Blow gets this place rocking, Curtis Blow says, well, you know, you all have this song, but you know, I have to say, I don't really understand it. And so many of, and look, when those sisters and brothers would come up to University of Rochester where I went to school, braving the campus with those name belts and those jackets, those bomber, we thought they were crazy. That was not hip to us. That looked like something, that you put that over there with punk rockers or something. And they were courageous. They're like, yeah, and they didn't care. And see, so you had a two-way misunderstanding. Now, the elders in New York City, though, if you take some of the disc jockeys, the people, they understood it because they were more connected to it. But there's a geography of music. So the geography of New York City doesn't lend itself to bands. You have, usually have to have a garage or a basement. You have Full Force and Fatback Band, but usually you have to be way up in the Bronx, up there probably where Dr. Canton is from up there to be able to have a band. So because of, and even the art forms, the instrumental art forms created in New York City, like bebop, they were often done in nightclubs and places where musicians could congregate for the most part. So, you know, we were not really appreciative of it. I didn't get down with hip hop until I got older and I started listening to the political hip hop. That's all wow. Public Enemy, KRS-One, all those artists in the 80s. By the 90s, I'm gonna end in a second just to show you the old school thing. By the 90s, with the Sinbad Soul Music Festivals, though, it's interesting. 1997, I wanna say, or 8, Melly Mel performs. And Sinbad comes out and says, you all wouldn't have this hip, and he puts his hoodie on, he tries it, he's making fun of 90s rap. But hip hop used to be something positive because he's reacting to the lyrical shift toward gangsterism in the 90s, which is obviously a reality, but he's already talking about an old school for hip hop in the 90s, which is so funny to listen to young people tell me, yo, the 90s was the golden age. So every era kind of reflects the aging and the aesthetic priorities of one generation to another. So that was what was going on with me. I came on board probably in the late 80s, But in the beginning, I could not understand it. And I think about all these other regions. My hometown, Rochester, is a lot more like most Black folks in the country that are in places like in Ohio, then in working town. It took a while for that stuff to really catch on. But once it did, once it became this powerful voice of expression for young people, there was no fortress that could stop it, because what I lost another debate, because I argued hip hop was like any other style that was going to come and go. I lost. I was wrong, because hip hop has, like water, a fluidity, an ability to absorb other styles. Like, if go-go would have been a style, go-go may have been able to do that. Or to a certain extent, dance hall does a little bit of that, but hip hop actually can go into very, very different styles, and it can grow with the sonic preferences of people. That's something we haven't seen anything like that on that level. So I didn't have a vocabulary for it. I'm not gonna sit up here and act like I always knew. Dave was right. I didn't know him yet. I met Dave, but I mean in '90s. By then, I tolerated him. I tolerated those New York guys by then. But early '90s, maybe '92, I think it was. So that is Professor Canton at it. So that is really what happened. And so if it was difficult for me, imagine what it was like for those music executives that I mentioned, who are, often very far removed from that cultural context. Many of them are in Los Angeles too. So they really are removed from what's happening in the latter 70s. Thank you. See some comments here. Do I think funk is perceived as being fast music? Most of the songs you play, isn't funk also slow too? Yes, well, that's very interesting. There is something called a funk ballad. I would say a funk ballad would be a song like Bootsy Collins' I'd Rather Be With You, right? That was, I think, Redbone uses a lot of that song in there, but Beyonce used I'd Rather Be With You. Wow. So they always have something in a ballad that makes it not as conventional. You can still feel the funk. It slows the tempo. The tempo doesn't take away something that you feel with a funk song. And Teddy Pendergrass, coming out of Gamblin' Huff Machine, I think is much more R&B and soul. But these are different things. Of course, Juicy Fruit and Toomey, who creates an 80s funk anthem, is probably one of the most juicy, is probably one of the most sampled records in history. His name is Toomey because he's a member of the group that I wrote my first book on. He was an original member of the US organization, and he was the drummer, percussionist, and activist in the dance troupe, and also in the militant, very militant US organization. And then he came back east and became a really successful songwriter. Closer I Get to You, Back Together Again, Donnie and Roberta, What You Gonna Do With My Lovin', Stephanie Mills, all of that is in Toomey and Reggie Lucas. He's a very, very unsung hero in R&B music, but he goes solo in the 80s in a way. He had done solo projects before, but the focus was much more stripped down in a way, like Cameo did, that could articulate funk for new ear preferences. That's it, yeah. I can't hear you, sir. Is your mic on?
I gotcha. What is the future and current status of funk given the over-digitization of music? Who is holding up the mantle for real music played with real instruments? Who are the bands left in the industry?
I'm gonna surprise you on this one. I don't think real music is necessarily played by real instruments. I don't think real instruments necessarily play real music. It's really about sound relationships. And for one thing about dealing with the kind of art form and the history that I do is I'll tell you what I'm trying not to do. I'm really trying not, it's the Black Peter Pan syndrome.
really trying not to get old. And what I mean by old, I don't mean, I want to gain some wisdom, but I don't want to develop a dependency on the formula that got me the answer in another era, because technology's changed. This same debate we're having about technology took place 50 years ago with electrification. There were people that felt like the upright bass was the real thing and the electrified bass guitar was not. So these debates have other forms, but the question is the spirit of it. So I hear, I listen to all the jazziness in Kendrick Lamar. I listen to, of course, you know, Outkast had members of Cameo. I'm still waiting for Andre 3000 to do something else, because whatever he does is always creative in a funk kind of way. Those are the veterans. And even the younger artists, I listen to this. The problem with hip hop artists and a lot of popular artists today is they usually unfortunately, so many of them have such a short shelf life. So when I listen to Rap Caviar, I'm often liking a song I've never heard this artist before. And chances are, you know, by the time you start really getting into them, people are saying, oh, no, that's washed up, Doc B. You dated. See, you know, so if you're just discovering Big Sean now, you're not really relevant. They got a whole nother group of folks out here. So I really like the Migos. Did you hear what they did with Papa Was a Rolling Stone? That was brilliant, right? So that's funk to me. That's funk. That's real music. So I don't think that funk is necessarily lodged within one particular artist. It could be that combination of the right producer, the right spirit that hits them. And I think funk is about those relationships, which under right circumstances, lots of people can do. And you know it when you hear it. That's what I believe.
All right, next question. What institution or part of the community do you feel was valuable to the emergence of this sound that was most overlooked?
What institution is most...
Right. What institution or part of the community do you feel was valuable to the emergence of this sound that was most overlooked?
You know, there's two places. Obviously, when you're talking about Black music, even to this day, I don't care how slick everybody gets, the Black church is still the place to be. That's where you will find the best musicians, the best artists, the most skilled people. I work with producers, and they come out of the church just tearing everybody up because of what they have to do in devotion requires such a high level of mastery. So they jam with me. They're like, okay, Doc, is that all you got? I'm like, yeah, that's all I got. You know, give me a break. But so the church is its own thing. Let's just stop acting like it's not serious or it's not relevant anymore. It is still the foundation for music making, in my opinion, right? Second, in terms of funk, is music teachers. So many of the funk artists, even ones that you don't think of in the way that we think artists that reads and writes music today, because that's so difficult to do. Well, young people in bands like Lakeside, young people in bands that some even dropped out of high school. Members of Slave, many of them dropped out of high school, but could read music as early as middle school. So teachers, church, and at the other institution, it's bigger than an institution. This is a force of nature in the world. Black mothers, Black moms. Black moms, I've discovered, were oftentimes the managers of groups. They were the ones making the uniforms, taking them to the talent shows, doing all the intangible things that make, just in the same way we talk about Black power and civil rights. We talk about Ella Baker, we talk about strategists. We say the person at the podium is not necessarily the most important. The same thing is the case with the story that I'm telling.
His other quote, at the time, it seemed that Black performers were not making much money, even in Motown. Now Mary J. Blige can buy a $12 million house in New Jersey. Travis Scott, Beyonce, and Jay-Z have financial multi-millions to sponsor scholarships to HBCUs, et cetera. Isn't this socioeconomic progress? Quote, don't this Black artist performers now have real control over their music and output?
You know, only because I was trained as a historian am I going to temper that optimism with some restraint. Only because over the sweep of history, what we found is that as soon as folks understand one thing, there becomes another thing, right? So at one time it was about getting your publishing. Then you get your publishing. Then you find out, oh, no, it's about distribution. Then it's not, then it's something else. So right now we're at this great moment. And I think, Professor Craig, Subi Craig can really articulate, we're at a moment where there's a possibility. However, because I understand how history has worked, I also know that there's the goalpost can constantly be reinvented and changed. It's a special moment. It's probably none other like it in the sense that you can get to your audience and you don't need the huge numbers of people to generate revenue. I know hip hop artists that live a upper middle class lifestyle who none of us have heard of. They have a following of maybe 4,000 or 5,000 people that spend about $100 on them a year. And so that is really, really important. And there's a lot of discussion now about blockchain and all of these new technologies of encryption that is very much an opening. But because of my consciousness from the, or the, not that I'm the higher, but the way I was informed and sometimes even traumatized, I have a level of caution. I'm not gonna start celebrating until we, I'm not spiking the ball until we're in the end zone. All right? And no celebrate, I don't care if I, nobody can, you can be 50 yards away from me. I'm not doing anything till we have it. And in the meantime, it is still a possibility, no matter how close we think we are. And that's, I think, you know, I know our people, we are, African people are some of the most creative folks on the planet. I have had the tendency in my own personal life of spiking the ball too early. You know, we want to go tell it on the mountain. Sometimes you have to get that power, and telling truth to power often is an expression of the fact that you don't really have power, which does not have to make a sound. So maybe we need to move in that direction. Once Professor Craig has this thing set and the checks are going in people's account, then we can talk about it. We probably need to lay low until we get it done, because I really, really see a pattern here, you know, concentrations of power that replicate themselves. Even when you have global change, power shifting, there's huge markets in China, huge markets, huge productive forces, there's globalization. Where do African people fit in all of this? We still have some fundamental questions to ask, in my opinion.
Do you think funk is perceived as being fast music? Most of the songs you played were fast up tempo. Isn't funk slow too? Teddy P, Mother's Finest?
Yes, Mother's Finest. Oh yeah, great. They do a combination of funk and rock. That's incredible, Mother's Finest. And those slow songs, if you notice, a lot of those slow jams are the ones that get sampled, and they'll just do some things, because now there's so much head bopping music out now, because Black folk are not congregating to engage music. And that was pre-COVID. Folks stopped dancing together a long time ago. You know, you go to the line, you go to these places, I'm still like, hi, would you like to dance? People look at you like you're crazy. You know, they think you're up to no good. You know, that's not what people do. They pop bottles, they sit in the VIP, there's something else going on. It's a different kind of socialization. I'm not trained in. So I feel like, wow, y'all are into something. Something's going on. I'm just not party to it. And dancing certainly is there as an individualized expression. But what you're really saying is, I'm paid, whether you're not. You're just really saying, I'm paid. You know, like, yeah. Okay, it's like James Brown said, pay the cost to be the boss. Look at me, what do you see? See a bad mother. That's going, all of that is in it. And it's beautiful, but dancing is not necessarily a part of it. So in that case, the tempos can slow down without disrupting the social environment. When you were at a party, when I was coming up and you dropped a slow song, and you didn't have someone interested in you enough to share close proximity with you, you're not having a good night, okay? That's nice. You can play that, nobody's dancing anyway, so it doesn't matter. You just, yeah, you know, it's another culture, it's another thing. It's all beautiful, it's all black, it's just, it's diverse, it's always changing.
I often pair black music with black sporting style, like hip hop and Iverson or funk and Dr. J. Has funk had an influence on other areas of black culture, such as sport, language, fashion? If so, how?
Say that one more time, the last often,
part. Has funk had an influence on other areas of black culture, such as sport, language, fashion? If so, how?
Yeah, I think it does, but, you know, it's interesting because funk, like other, like art forms, elements of funk also got absorbed. So disco embraced a lot of the glam and glitz of funk. So the difference between hip hop and funk, when I say hip hop, I'm talking after you leave Afrika Bambaataa, when you get to Run DMC, the aesthetic is such where the artist prides himself on looking like they would look walking the streets. P-Funk is not doing that. It's a theatrical experience with funk artists. Mm-hmm. So they're not gonna influence fashion in the same way because it's about the spectacle of the look. You come off the mothership, you wanna look like black astronauts or black from Mars. So you don't walk down the street wearing your hair. I've never seen anybody wearing their hair like Rick James out here, but Rick James could do that. You see what I mean? Whereas with Run DMC, rebelled against the excesses of that and said, what we have on the streets is fly enough. And so, and you didn't see that. I mean, when they walk into the dressing room and when they come on stage, they're often wearing the same outfits, black Levi jeans and Adidas and leather, and that's it, right? And in that respect, they were very much more like the rock bands. That's what AC/DC did. That's what Rush did. That was what REO Speedwagon did, or Fleetwood Mac, you know? They were always dressed that way, whereas some of the inaccessibility of discos that were, if you didn't look a certain way, you couldn't get in. If you didn't look like you had money, you couldn't get in. That had a lot to do with that rebellion as well. So that look, a lot of that funk style got absorbed by disco. And most of funk's contribution is sonic. But even still today, when, you know, it's interesting with black culture, we have these bouts of sort of realism, and then we get back to the surreal. Trust me, you start off with black leather, next thing you know, you got diamond studs on you. It's gonna come back to something else. Trust me. First you start off with a dashiki, next thing you know, you got something else as loud as all get out. So we have an ebb and flow. And that part of the aesthetic is where funk actually still is there, because when you see the flamboyance, and particularly in black male culture, because bands are dominated by men. Someone asked about the misogyny. I think that change is coming about by a more democratic inclusion, an insurgency of women artists playing instruments, being in roles of producers. That's gonna actually has to be a power shift to change those dynamics. But in black male culture, and some of these brothers are not gonna admit this in the room, But this is the truth. I can wear a green suit and green shoes and green socks and a green hat. If they see me out and I'm stepping with confidence now, in other words, when Drew Brown looks at me, I look at him like, yeah, that's right. He's going to say, I see you. I see you over there. I see you, because the stridency is appreciated. And it's a different, and you rarely hear people say, you know, who told him he could wear that? Because the culture is, if you can muster the confidence to wear something that outrageous, I mean, look at these pimp outfits. All of that stuff is a part of a very tricky aesthetic in which funk plays a role. The absurdity is there. There's obviously a lot of absurdity. There's a satirical dimension to it. And all of that kind of gets into the potpourri of the aesthetic in terms of the fashion choices. But now the problem with hip hop was, hip hop said, we want control. So I remember that line, FUBU, for us, by us. There's some tremendous possibilities that hip hop brought on that the funk era didn't. That is to say, now I don't know if they accomplished it because of globalization and labor or disorganization globally and the move to higher profits. But the idea of actually possibly even manufacturing products that Black people consume, hip hop made leaps and bounds, more strides in that direction than funk or any other genre, in my opinion. Thinking about control and ownership.
Let me get this other, all right, here's a question. After these organic Black musical art forms, funk, hip hop are created, what happens to the art form? Is it affected by colonialism, capitalism, and commercialization? If so, how?
It is always affected by the social, economic, and political context. So, what does this brother always tell me? Capitalism, and he says, decapitates the rhythm or something. Well, it's the commodification of sound that, and the commodification of images that often, unfortunately, because our market level of control is such that we can't have classic. So Black musicians and Black music is much more driven by what's hot. We're looking for the new Chris Brown. You know, we're looking, so you have a breakthrough change, and then we are much more driven by, so you don't, for instance, as I said in this Joe Madison show, I don't care how many White folks or non-Black folks are playing instruments, the Beatles model of the rock band is not going anywhere. It's a classic art form, meaning that there are executives that will preserve it, as we say, irregardless, like regardless times 10, it will be here. So that's not going anywhere. So if they have to go to England to find some guys that sound like they're going to find them. If they have to go to Australia, they're going to find them. They call them all kinds of names. The Cure. What's this last one? Coldplay. Everybody told me I had to hear Coldplay. I was like, wow. Where'd they come from? Who said they were the superstar? So, and again, if you watch Jimmy Fallon, Saturday Night Live, I guarantee you in over a week, you will see a band up there you've never heard of. And they are just singing away and doing it because they have the support. They have capital that has said, this is a classic form. We do not have that. And if people want bars in hip hop, if you want less misogyny, if you want creativity, forget about all the overemphasis on sex. Those are questions about power. Mm-hmm. The power of within our community and the power of us in relation to others. So we need a more democratic, we need more inclusive aspects of our community, especially women involved in leadership. And we need more control within the wider context of how music gets put out. those limitations to me are expressions of that power differential.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, we're going to, you know, like I said, Scott can go all night cracking up irregardless. Yeah. He's sweating like in the church, brother.
Hey, I got this big light on me over here. And I'm, you know, I want, if I turn this off, I look like I'm whispering in the dude, footsteps in the dark or something. You know, Isaac Brothers stuff like. So.
Well, this was, like I said, the African Counter Studies approach to Black music. And this is what we're talking about. This is what we're trying to build here at UF, where, like I said, it's engaging, the music part, you know, and what makes Black studies unique, right? Where the music you play, the church being the center. We know, right, all them from the youth choir to the recitals, all of that stuff. And that's what makes Black studies, right? Where you get the academic, the community, all connected. All came through these institutions.
That's right.
And I think in this time for us to acknowledge that, and who's the audience that you're speaking to, so whether it means, you know, what if turn you in sorority, church, whatever, that you can say it bold and loud and keep it moving. And it's just as academic as, you know, Western philosophy, whatever they're talking about in there. Right. So I appreciate that, you know, the enthusiasm, and appreciate folks coming out and joining us for our convocation. So remember, the book is coming out. Check our website for other events. And this was great. People enjoyed it. Give Dr. Brown a hand. It'll be recorded, and it'll be on our website probably on Monday, his talk. So if people couldn't make it tonight, please let them check out the talk. And, you know, since we started Particular Way, we're going to end on this song, because I don't know if Mike Powell, you still in the house? All right, Joey, have a good night. There you go. I see you, Brother Jay.
All right. Thank you.